Hey, so today I'm gonna break down my process of creating Tifa from Final Fantasy VII. If you missed the last video, I posted a time-lapse of Tifa from start to finish in a span of 8 minutes with some fun editing to the music, so go check it out if you haven't yet so that you see the whole process of creating her before we actually jump into the walkthrough. I'll add the link in the description below. So in this video, I'm gonna do a walkthrough of Tifa. I'll give tips, tricks, I'll talk about my whole process, go through all of these stages. Now this is gonna be at least a 2-part video, so make sure to subscribe to the channel and hit that notification bell so that you get notified when part 2 comes out, and there might even be a 3rd part if you guys really enjoy the video, so make sure to like it if you do at the end of the video. Anyways, let's get right to it. In case you're new to the channel or 3D in general, I'll start by covering my weapons of choice for sculpting Tifa. The program I'll be using here is called Blender. It is a free 3D program that has many different functions, which can make the whole process of creating a character a bit smoother without having to switch to any other program. I got beginner tutorials on Blender on the channel, which I'll link in the description. You can check them out after watching this video. Moving on, since a lot of you asked about the graphics tablets I use, this is the Humion Canvas Pro 22, which I recently bought and of which I am so far very satisfied with. I'll add some affiliate links to the tablet in the description if you are interested in checking it out. Okay, all of that is great and all, but let's dive into the actual creation of Tifa. As usual, I like to start sculpting from a sphere when creating characters, as it is easy to quickly shape it to an organic form as opposed to something like a cube. Here I'll move that sphere around and shape it to look like a basic head shape, then I will add a few new spheres for the neck, ears, and the eyes. You can sculpt these forms directly from the original sphere, however, sculpting these parts separately can sometimes make things easier. After adding the eyes, I'll indicate the orbit area which surrounds the eyeballs, then bulk up the nose and the mouth shortly after. While doing that, I'll sculpt in some of the bony landmarks of the face, which I can later soften up to suit the style of the character. Here's a little tip, placing the eyes early on can be very helpful for the proportions of the face. Even more so would be getting all of the facial features and body landmarks down swiftly and figuring out their relationship to each other before refining them. Think of building the basic forms first and then adding the details as a good habit to start with, but nothing is wrong with developing different methods if they better suit you. In fact, I tend to approach this stage differently depending on my mood and the character I'm creating. Now, the proportions are not set in stone yet, but as I finish getting down most of the basic landmarks and face features, I'll start to refine these areas to develop them further, such as adding the eyelids. As the face gets more fleshed out, I'll continue to adjust the proportions and move the shapes all around to preserve a certain amount of harmony all over. Here I just added some colors by setting some flat values. However, this is only visible in the viewport. These colors have nothing to do with the final renders or textures. Think of them as making things pretty for you guys while watching the creation of the character, so it isn't really that essential to the process, but it can be very useful for visualizing the character early on by having the right colors set in. A face without eyebrows and in some cases eyelashes can tend to look very different from a face with them. This is why I like adding them early on to faster establish the character I'm creating. The method in which I use to make the eyebrows is different from how I sculpted the head. I do this for a few different reasons. I'll quickly demonstrate this method as you will see me use it in various different things for Tifa, such as the clothes and accessories. Now this is really cool because the way I'm gonna do it is that I'm gonna model it on the form of the object, and then it will follow the form even if I sculpt the form later on without having to do anything manually. So, to show you how I do this, it's quite simple. We need the target. I'm gonna use a speed sculpt of a goblin that I did, and I'll create another object for the eyebrows, so a plane. And then in edit mode, I can just merge it at center, and I'll have a vertex point. Now I want it to stick to the face, so I'm going to activate the snap tool over here and make sure that I choose face and project individual elements so that when I move it around, it's gonna move around the face of the goblin. Now, if I start extruding this just to quickly represent the shape of the eyebrows, like so, I can then add some modifiers. So the first one is the mirror modifier for it to mirror to the other side, and then a subdivision surface modifier to have more vertices, so more points. And then we can add a shrink wrap modifier, so that's where all the magic happens. Let me just quickly modify this over here. There you go, perfect. So for the shrink wrap modifier, we can click on the color picker and then target the object, so the face. We want it to follow anything that happens with the face. And then I will basically, first of all, change the mode on surface to above surface, so that stays on, well, on the surface of the face, and then increase the offset for it to start further from the face of the goblin. I can also add some thickness. As you can see, it's just a flat plane, which doesn't make sense for eyebrows. So what we're gonna do is we will add a solidify modifier to add some thickness, like so. And then we can also add another subdivision surface modifier to smooth it out. All right, so now you can always go to edit mode and move the object, move the object around. So you can just move the vertices to change the shape of the eyebrows. And the really cool thing about the shrink wrap modifier is that if I grab the goblin and I go to sculpt mode and I move, for example, the bro around, if I push it inwards like this, you can see there's a space going on over here. But if I go back to object mode, it will stick to the changes. And that is thanks to the shrink wrap modifier. As for the hair, I like to do it in different steps. Just like how I would sculpt the face, I will block the basic forms and gesture of the hair. For that, generally I start sculpting the basic form in big shapes, which you will see me do here. I do it by grabbing spheres and moving them around, taking into account how Tifa's hair is groomed by observing the various references that I have of her. Even though I am doing my own take on her, I still have to make conscious decisions on which parts of the original concept I want to preserve and which parts I would like to deviate from. For now, I'll only do enough shapes to get the basic feel of her hair. I would like to get her whole figure down before I move any further to keep some harmony all around. I'll start sculpting the body in a very similar fashion to the face. I'll start with a sphere, then quickly shape around the basic forms with some indications to the bony landmarks and muscles of one part of the body like the torso, and then repeat the process for the legs, arms, and other parts of the body. I initially create the body parts separately for two main reasons. First of all, parts like the axilla, more known as the armpits area, is a lot easier to sculpt if the torso is separated from the arm. But even more, it is easier to play around with the proportions of the body by scaling the separate parts and adjusting them before they're connected. I simply merge them later on and refine the areas where they are separated. One quick note, don't be surprised if you see me going back to the face while working on the body from time to time. I'll keep jumping back and forth throughout the sculpt and slowly refining all of the areas of the character. As I mentioned, I like to keep a certain harmony present throughout the whole process. While sculpting the body, I will also try to win some time by planning ahead on which parts of her clothes and accessories will I sculpt directly on her without sculpting or refining her body underneath. Some examples that come to mind for Tifa will be the forearms, you know, for the gloves, the pelvic area since the skirt is covering it, her feet, you know, since she has shoes, and other parts. Be aware, this could mess up the accuracy of these areas if you are not careful or experienced. In that case, it will be better to take the longer road and sculpt the whole body first, then add the outfit later. Another example of how I planned ahead to gain some time is how I sculpt the chest area as if her shirt was on, while I will continue to sculpt the rest of the torso without her shirt, knowing that I'll use the method that I showed you for the eyebrows for her tank tops, as you can see over here. Now for her tank tops, you'll notice that I will start with a black one, then duplicate it so that I have the white one over it, just like Tifa in the Final Fantasy VII Remake. This, however, is something I change later on when I texture her. I end up using some of her design in the Final Fantasy VII Remake, like the skirt, but change or even disregard others. Don't hesitate to play around with the concept or make changes when creating your characters. Keep an open mind throughout the whole process. Since I created the shirt using the methods I showed you for the eyebrows, it will always follow any changes I make on the body. This way I can hide it anytime to further refine the shape of the torso, as you can see over here. This makes the workflow non-destructive. I will play around with the forearm cloth and make it longer to see if that ends up looking better. Again, always experiment with the concept till you reach a conclusion that suits you, no matter which stage of the character creation you are at. It is time to merge the lower and upper leg to work on the knee area. Merging objects will depend on the program you're using. In Blender, you can use the Boolean modifier to do it, or you can use the Bool tool add-on, which is in Blender by default. You just have to activate it. I will create the skirt like the one Tifa has in Final Fantasy VII Remake by using good old 3D modeling and the method I showed you on the eyebrows. Here I will merge the arms with the torso and clean things up. Generally in this area, you want to pay attention to where the clavicle and acromion ends are. The clavicle being the collarbone and the acromion being part of the scapula or shoulder blade. Where they are placed will determine things like where the trapezius muscles end, where the deltoids muscles start, and much more. Also, pay attention to the axilla, which is more known as the armpits. This is a tricky one if you are not aware of all of the muscles that converge around that area, so I strongly advise you to look up the anatomy of the axilla. Right now I am setting up the fingers. I sculpt the hands in many different ways, mostly depending on my mood. Sometimes I sculpt the fingers directly from the hand, however for some people it can prove to be difficult to control since the fingers tend to be close to each other. For this character, I'll model the basic shape of one finger, duplicate it, and then place them where the hands are, in a somewhat neutral, relaxed position. Pay good attention to your hands and notice how the fingers are somewhat slightly flexed and have a nice curve from the second digit, also known as the index finger, to the fifth digit or the pinky where the hands are relaxed. After having the digits in position, I'll merge them with the hands and then sculpt out the fleshy padded region, which is the palmar side of the hand, and sculpt the bony forms of the dorsal side of the hand, which is the top or back side of your hands. When working on forms that are close to each other like the fingers, don't be afraid to use the mask brush, which all or most of sculpting programs should have. You will have a much easier time working these areas that way. I'll add the gloves and elbow bands in the same way I did the eyebrows, then move on to creating the elbow shield by 3D modeling it with some simple shapes. You'll notice that I duplicated it, and while I modify the shape of one, the other one follows the modifications. This is because I duplicated it with Alt-D instead of Shift-D, making an instance. It is a little easier to model things accurately if they are not rotated, which is why I did it. And it is more of a non-destructive way of doing things, but there are different methods to this. Now I'll pull her hair down and add a hair ribbon. Then I will jump in to add the belt. You will notice that a lot of the methods I explained earlier will be used frequently again and again for different parts of Tifa's character creation. Now I'm going to prepare some curves for the clothes straps. This method will also be used for the hair strands and shoelaces, so I'll quickly demonstrate what is going on. Let's take a look at Tifa over here to see how curves work. So first things first, if I grab the hair and I go to edit mode, you'll see that I have points that I can move around easily. As such, I can scale them up and down with Alt S, and I can use Ctrl T to rotate the curves. So the way you do this is very, very simple. All you gotta do is, let me just grab a curve with Shift A. So I'll create a curve, a path, and then I'll create another curve, a circle. Okay. So this circle over here will dictate the shape of this path over here. So if I go to the path, and I click on curves options, I can go to geometry, bevel, and color pick the circle. So right now we have the same shape. So if I grab the circle, I can scale it up and down. I can play around with the shape over here with the points, as you can see. And once you're done, you can just grab this curve over here. You can go to edit mode and do exactly the same thing. So Alt S to scale it down. You can duplicate it and have another hair curve. You can go like that. You can scale this part, for example, to have the shape of the hair, and so on and so forth. Using the method I just demonstrated, I can easily position her straps and make any future changes if needed with a minimum amount of hassle. Working with curves can be useful for a bunch of things, and it is somewhat of a less destructive method of working than if I had to manually model the straps, shoelaces, or hair strands, as we will see later on. Nothing fancy here, just adding some elements to these straps to make them a bit more believable. Like how they attach to the skirt and to each other. You don't have to go beyond on the details to make something believable. As you can see, these are just simple shapes that I'm adding. Here I'm setting up the shoes for the next step. I plan to use the method I showed you on the eyebrows for the different parts of the shoes. To do that, I'll first sculpt and clean up the boots enough to have a base, then retopologize over it as we can see over here. To start the shoelace, I'll duplicate the curve from these straps and go from there. I took a look at my own shoes to see how the shoelace fits in, as that part can be deceiving. Don't be afraid to look around your house for reference, that can be very helpful. You'll also notice that instead of making the whole thing from one curve by extruding the points over and over again, I duplicate separate curves for each part of the shoelace. I did do the whole shoelace as one single curve in the past for some other characters on the channel, but I found out that this way is just a lot simpler. Curves can sometimes twist in a weird way in certain situations when creating complex forms. Using different curves can help avoid that hassle. Even though they are separate curves, I still have to make sure that it looks like one single shoelace, so I'll make sure to place all of the parts in a continuous looking form. As for the shoelace knot, I did a quick Google search to have reference on what it looks like and did something similar by duplicating the curves and moving the points around and twisting the form. I'll quickly finish up the shoes here, again using methods I already showed, so nothing fancy. Now that most of the basic stuff are out there, I'll go back and do some cleanup to prep for the retopology stage. If you don't know what that means, I'll talk about it in a minute when we get there. Here I'll just go over the body and clean up the anatomy a bit. I don't really need to go overboard with the details as the retopology stage will smooth the muscle forms anyways. I'll just go back and work on the details in a later stage. Keep in mind that if I didn't plan to retopologize the character, I would have refined the sculpt and muscles a lot more at this point instead of later. I'm going to start working on the ears since I left that part way simpler than I would like for the style I'm going for, which would be stylized for sure, with a hint of anatomical realism. Just quickly modeling the earrings here, nothing fancy, I'll keep it simple. Okay, so time to retopologize the character. Now I'm pretty sure a lot of you have many questions on this section, so let me answer some of them. The method I'm using to retopologize the character is exactly the same as I did with the eyebrows. Since that was covered earlier, I'll skip explaining that. If you've never heard of retopology before, this is basically a way to turn a highly dense sculpt into a cleaner lower poly mesh. This can be helpful for many reasons, and whether you want or need to do this part is up to what you plan to do with the character and how you want to approach things. First of all, if you want to animate a character, then retopology becomes almost essential. However, if you watch the time-lapse video I made of Tifa, you will know that animation isn't what I have planned for her. Here, I'm retopologizing her for a few reasons. First of all, considering the style I'm going for, I want a clean, smooth look that I can resculpt over later on without having to smooth out the sculpt manually all over. Moreover, it will make posing and texturing her a lot easier. That said, it is still doable without any retopology and I don't always do it, so really, it's up to you. Also, keep in mind, since I will not animate her, I don't really need to make a super clean topology. I just need to make one that conserves her forms and focus on getting it done as fast as possible, since this part can be a bit time consuming. I also only have to retopologize the body at this point, since most of the clothes were created with this method to start with, so they are already made low poly as we have seen earlier, which is one of the reasons I create them with the method that I showed you with the eyebrows. Here I'll use the retopologized glove to create the bare fingers by duplicating it, scaling it slightly bigger, and deleting the area of the distal digits or fingers. I'll continue to shape the gloves, then finish adding the different parts of her outfit such as the white bandages, another elbow strap, more parts for the shoes, and a place for the shoelaces to enter through. You'll also see me scale down the curves of the shoelaces where they go through the torus. Sometimes a little attention to detail and how things work can make a difference. I'm going to add some stuff for the gloves here, and I'm basically looking at the Tifa references that I have, observing her outfit, and choosing to add some elements, remove some, and modify some in my version of her to suit the overall style that I'm going for. Here I decided to add some fingernails, so I will model one and then use that as a base for the others. You'll also see me looking at my own fingers to double check the form and how they fit in the fingers and make necessary changes. Keep in mind that there are different shapes of fingernails, so even though I am using my fingers as reference for the overall anatomy of the area, I'm still gonna go for a different shape and look to suit the character that I'm working on. This is to say that if you have a good anatomy knowledge, you can use yourself as reference, whether it is for the face, body, or any other parts for any type of character. I will get back to clean up the face and add missing parts like the caruncle, which is the pinkish parts in the corner of the inner side of the eyes. I also decided to play around with the eyelashes and eyebrows to make them look a little more interesting. Alright, time to work on the hair. I'll start by grabbing the curve like I did with the outfit straps and the shoelaces, using a different shape for the hair strands. I can then use that curve to continue adding more hair strands while playing around with the size, taper, and twist for each strand for a more natural and aesthetic look. While doing that, I'll also sculpt the big hair shapes that I initially added and use that with the hair curves as a nice mix to quickly bulk up the hair volume. I can always add more hair strands later on to keep the overall look in harmony if needed. Keep in mind while working on the hair that there is some logic to how it works. Pay attention to how the hair parts and where the strands start and end. No matter how stylized you want to go, try to keep some logic behind your work to make your characters believable to some extent. One last thing, while I'm refining the hair, I'm gonna keep in mind that when I pose her, some of the hair strands will behave differently depending on how her head is tilted and if there are strands interacting with her clothes. So I'll keep finalizing her hair on hold till after I'm done with the pose later on.
Alright, I think that's pretty much more than enough for one video, so how about we just leave it for part 2 where I still have to rig, pose the character, unwrap her, and then texture her, render her, lighting. There's still a lot of stuff to cover. So if you really enjoyed the video, I can separate it to another two parts so that I can have more video time to cover the information. Otherwise, I'll just compile it into one part and just finish the whole thing in a part two. So let me know in the comment section below. Give the video a like if you enjoyed it so that I can know. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel. Hit that notification bell so that you get notified when part two comes out. Either way, I'll see you guys in the next one. Make sure to subscribe to the channel for more awesome character sculpts and art related videos. You can also check out my store for full courses on character sculpting, texturing, materials, brushes, and more. Last but not least, if you enjoyed this video, then you will definitely enjoy the next one.